A young man named David has been in the hospital for about a week, undergoing a variety of tests, treatments, and recovery processes following an open-heart surgery. The year is 2017. David has had a lifelong heart condition known as aortic stenosis, which recently became so severe he required a valve replacement in order to prevent his heart from failing. The surgery was successful. In order to help David deal with the inevitable pains that follow open-heart surgery, he is given cocktails of pain medications each day. A few of these medications, however, make David horribly sick, delirious, and ultimately worse off. David experiences horrible nausea and vomiting, which begins to pose problems on his healing sternum. His reactions are so harsh, he has to stop taking many of the medications. This eliminates his reactions and reduces his vomiting, but the pain of the recovery becomes far worse. In order to help the situation, David's doctor tells him about an alternative, non-traditional method of pain reduction that the hospital has recently started offering. He tells David it's a program where patients can use state-of-the-art virtual reality equipment after and in between treatments, which is shown to help reduce patients' pain. At first, this sounds pretty ridiculous to David. He's heard of virtual reality before and knows what it is, but is completely dumbfounded by the idea that it could possibly help with his pain. The doctor tells David that it won't actually eliminate or even reduce the pain, but that it should help distract him from it. David decides to give it a try. It couldn't hurt. In the following couple weeks, David spends a portion of each day with the virtual reality headset on in a room with other patients doing the same. To David's surprise, he actually feels much better during this time. Not good, but better. He visits the moon, goes deep sea diving, builds cities, visits beautiful natural landmarks, plays games, and mostly forgets about his pain. It's amazing. Soon, David's condition stabilizes enough to return to his normal life. He returns home to his job, his family, his friends, his routine. Within a few days of leaving the hospital, David decides to purchase his own virtual reality setup to help with the lingering pains that will persist in the following months of the recovery process. A couple years go by. David has long been fully recovered from the surgery. At the end of each night, however, David continues to use virtual reality, escaping to many of the same locations, games, and applications that he spent time at in the hospital and during his recovery thereafter. He has, more or less, formed a habit out of it. It helps him forget about the stresses of his day-to-day, and David finds it very enjoyable, just how one might enjoy a video game or their favorite TV show at the end of each day. A couple more years go by. The year is 2022. A newly emerging tech company by the name of Replica comes out with a revolutionary virtual reality product known as Replica Virtual World. The product is revolutionary on account of its new lens technology that breaks through the limitations of previous display methods and synchronizes with the functions of the human eye using a stable 360-degree lens device the size of prescription glasses. With this device, a real-time interactive, full-resolution, and completely functional virtual world can now be accessed and inhabited. Of course, David purchases it as soon as it becomes available to the public. He receives it, opens up the minimalistic package, puts on the glasses, and loads up the default landing map, a city street filled with other people, traffic, buildings, trees, birds, and so on. Immediately disoriented, David takes a second to realize what he's looking at. Unlike all other virtual reality products, apps, games, and platforms that he had previously used, where the trees never really casted believable shadows, the grass didn't move right, most of the animals and people were all a bit off, and the motions and controls never quite felt natural. This virtual reality looked and felt like reality. So much so that David actually needs to take a moment to mentally adjust to the idea that it isn't. As David begins to acclimate and realize what he's experiencing, an ecstasy flows over him. It literally feels like he's been reborn into a new world with endless new possibilities. He spends the whole night exploring. Like the camera was to film and TV, like the personal computer was to the internet, like the internet was to the smartphone, like the smartphone was to social media, David experiences the next massive breakthrough in technology and entertainment that would change everything forever. A breakthrough so potent that he could feel it, a sort of disorienting and overwhelming elation where a sci-fi concept of the future suddenly becomes a real technology of the present. A couple more years go by. The year is 2024. Virtual reality, in general, is no longer just popular among fringe users like David, but has become fully accepted into the commonplace of culture and behavior. Just like how in the past, the norm would be to go home and watch TV, or go on the computer after work or school, or how one might spend time on their smartphone while waiting in line at the grocery store, Now, individuals spend their spare time engaging in the Replica platform, bringing their glasses with them wherever they go, turning them on whenever they have a spare second, and using them to provide a spike of dopamine at the beginning and end of each day. As a result of this now global phenomenon, many new companies begin developing within the virtual and augmented reality space. Companies focused on virtual entertainment, applications, data, advertising, events, maps, games, securities, currencies, virtual land exchange, and so on. David becomes obsessed. Instead of going out to social events, he engages more frequently in virtual social events. Instead of traveling much or going to museums and landmarks, he visits destinations and learns about things virtually. Instead of creating art with physical materials and consuming it in physical spaces, he makes, shares, and enjoys art through virtual mediums, galleries, shows, and so on. He soon even begins making his living virtually, buying and selling virtual land properties, advertising space, and filling jobs and roles that assist in virtual needs, all without ever needing to leave his couch. Flash forward to the year 2058. Replica releases a software update that provides a fully mapped and augmented world that integrates entirely with the physical world. In other words, the Replica virtual world can now layer on top of the real world, rendering the real world virtually interactive, linked with apps, medias, games, functions, entertainments, and so on, at all times. David, along with essentially everyone who hasn't isolated themselves from the modern world, can now jump between the virtual world and the real world, and a combination of both. Even the most tedious things of daily life are now covered with media, games, and modifiable experience. What had once merely been a means of assisting his pain during his time in the hospital so many years ago, now makes things like grocery shopping pleasurable and rife with entertainment. The technology quickly becomes easier, more well integrated, more passive, more entertaining. David experiences new realms of personal experience as the ability to see out of other people's perspectives becomes an option for those interested in selling or paying for it. David experiences the perspectives of celebrities, athletes, and other public figures that upload and monetize their visual data. Not unlike everyone else, David never leaves the house without his glasses. He wears them to bed and only takes them off right before falling asleep, if at all. As soon as he wakes up the next morning, the first thing he does is put them back on. He wears them essentially at all times, feeling completely strange and naked without them. It's not really considered addiction because everyone's doing it, but nonetheless, David is not in control. As the future unfolds more and more, lifespans increase with the development of better medical technologies and higher levels of information. As a result of increasing lifespans, the demand for new virtual worlds, improved augmentations, and software updates that offer better qualities of entertainment and novel experience also increases. In the year 2122, Replica releases a product that allows individuals to undergo a simple procedure which modifies the retina in the human eye, connects it to the Replica data cloud, and allows the human eye to function just like the lens devices of the past. It requires some control from a pocket-sized remote device, but otherwise requires no physical hardware or wearable technology. Not long after its release, infants are given this procedure almost unanimously within 48 to 72 hours of birth. Completely out of their own control, somehow born into this time of history in which they are swallowed whole by technology with no choice but to engage or completely opt out of society. Reality and virtual reality essentially merge and become indiscernible from one another. As the world delves deeper and deeper into the virtual dimension, the human brain loses more and more of its orientation and ability to properly form a singular sense of self. People can just reverse the procedure if they want, but they don't. Anxiety and alienation increases rapidly, and there is even more demand for higher levels of entertainment and virtual immersion to help distract people from their growing problems. The demand is filled as more and more money is thrown at it. Globally, people become sick, mentally disoriented, and suicidal. People can virtually go anywhere and do anything, yet they feel lost. People can see and know anything in an instant, yet they feel numb and brain dead. People can be friends with millions of other people from all over the world, yet they feel isolated and lose track of who their real friends are. Years and years go by. The year is 2141. David hasn't had to think or feel in years. His memory of his prior life and self have faded into the distance of ones and zeros, blended and overridden by the characters and worlds he has formed and lived through. Like how the opening of inebriate asylums occurred in the 18th and 19th centuries in order to combat prevalent drug and alcohol addiction, a new category of medical and addiction treatment centers develop that are focused entirely on virtual and technological addictions, ailments, and mental conditions. After attempting to off himself, David is administered into a treatment center. He's in bad shape, experiencing a psychological problem known as virtual dissociative disorder, with only his original username, David_Greenwood, connecting him to his earlier self. As means of treatment, David goes through a number of software updates, augmentation adjustments, and so on. They all make him worse off. Around the same time, a doctor specializing in the field comes out with a brand new technology that proves to be exceptionally effective for people in similar conditions to David. The doctor is seen as revolutionary and regarded as the leader of a newly developing medical practice. David, along with innumerable amounts of other people, is sent to this doctor. David finds himself in a massive hospital lobby with a huge group of other people in similar states. One by one, they are brought into this doctor. Eventually, David is brought in. The doctor explains the technology to David as best he can. Once he finishes, he proceeds to take out a pair of glasses. He hands them to David and instructs him to put them on. David puts them on. Immediately disoriented, David takes a second to realize what he's looking at. He sees the doctor, the chair that he's sitting in, a countertop, a sink, and blank walls, one with a weird painting hanging on it. Alarmed, David asks, Where is everything? Where did all the apps and portals and files and icons go? They're gone. Like I explained, the glasses take them away, replies the doctor. David begins to panic a little and quickly removes the glasses. The doctor tells David, David, I need you to trust me. I'm going to give you a few moments to sit here alone and try them again. I want you to try your best to relax and just observe for a little while and see how you feel. Okay? The doctor gets up and leaves David to himself. Confused, David waits a moment and then puts the glasses back on, again revealing the empty, still room. For the first time in decades, David sits completely with himself. No apps, no games, no entertainment, no virtual worlds to jump to, no people to experience through. Nothing. He looks around the room and down at the chair he's sitting on. Out of habit, he swipes at the arm of the chair with his finger. Nothing happens. He sits and does nothing. It hurts. After a couple minutes that feel like days go by, some fragmented parts of his original self start to scramble across his consciousness, like faded memories of a previous night's dream sprouting up in the middle of the next day. Soon, the doctor comes back in. So, how are we doing? He asks David. I don't know. I feel weird and anxious, like I don't know what to do with myself other than to think about who I am or what I am or why I am. It kind of hurts, and I think I want to take the glasses off again. Okay, David, you're welcome to take the glasses off if you'd like, replies the doctor. David takes them off. Confused, David asks, I don't get it. How would these help? They don't do anything. Correct. That's the treatment, replies the doctor. Huh? David grunts with further confusion. How would that help at all? David asks. The doctor pauses for a moment, puts on his own glasses, looks David in the eyes, and says, That anxiety you were feeling, that weird sense of what it means to be you in this empty room right now, with nothing to do other than to be you in this empty room, that's still there, with or without the glasses on. You're sick, David. We're all sick. And these glasses help us see how sick we really are. Why would anyone want that? Replies David. No one would, the doctor answers. But what we want isn't always what's good for us. We can fill our life with all the games, apps, new worlds, entertainment, and whatever else. You can escape into other people's perspectives, pretend you're not you, come up with new versions of you, but you'll always be you with your perspective at the end of it all. You can take the glasses off right now and leave them off. You can go back into the world where everything is set up perfectly to distract you from you, exploiting that desire to escape yourself. Or, once in a while, you can put these glasses on and face yourself and your sickness. You can sit with it, think about it, and try your best to deal with it and make it okay. But then what? What about normal life? What about everything and everyone else without these glasses? David asks. There's nothing wrong with taking the glasses off. There's nothing wrong with all of the screens and augmentations and games and entertainment and everything else. But if you're always there, you're inevitably gonna forget what's real underneath it all. That you're really alone in this empty room. If just once in a while you use these glasses to remind yourself of this, then whenever you take the glasses back off to re-enter the world of noise, you might still have a little bit of yourself to hold on to. A little bit of truth, a little bit of strength. In the following weeks, David spends a portion of each day with the glasses on in a room with other patients doing the same. To David's surprise, he actually feels much better during this time. Not good, but better. He looks at the walls and notices the little subtle bumps in the paint on the drywall. He observes the patterns in the wood of the chairs, the speckles on the tiles of the floor, the lines on the skin of his hands. He talks with the other patients in the room. They laugh together. They suffer together. It's amazing.